Good evening, buenas tardes. It's TV6's Montse Ricossa. Thank you all for joining us for this COVID-19 vaccine educational event. We know how hard this year has been, and information continues to be evolving. That has been difficult for everyone, but especially those where English is not their first language. Up-to-date information is not always presented to us in Spanish or in a way that we can easily understand. We know COVID-19 has affected so many people, but especially people of color. In the Quad Cities, Latinos make up about 10% of our population, but nearly a quarter of all positive cases when the pandemic first started. That's why today, with the help of Unity Point Health Trinity, WVIK, the Rock Island County Health Department, and so many more, we're able to bring you answers to the questions that you have given us. And if you have more questions, you will have a chance to talk with our local health experts. A quick tease of the topics that we'll be covering tonight: disclosure of personal information when getting a vaccine, a description of what is in the vaccine and its effectiveness, and reviewing different guidelines that we have in the Quad Cities. We also have live subtitles in Spanish in this video, and I will be summarizing the key points in Spanish after an especially important question. Before we get into that, we should introduce our wonderful panelists. For those of you that don't know me, I'm Montse Ricossa, KWQC's weekend anchor and first bilingual reporter. I was born in Mexico City and moved into the States when I was about 5 years old. And since then, I've been really passionate about making sure that our Spanish-speaking community, especially in the Quad Cities, has all of the information that they need and in a way that is easily accessible to them. And I just received my first COVID-19 vaccine, feeling great, and I encourage all of you to get it as soon as you can as well. Now on to our other incredible panelists, Dr. Jared Terronez with Unity Point Health Trinity. Good evening, doctor. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, why you're so passionate about helping the Latino community?
Absolutely. Thank you, Montse. My name is Dr. Jared Terronez, like Montse mentioned there. I'm currently a family medicine doctor over here in the Quad Cities in Bettendorf, specifically at Unity Point Family Care Partners. I was born and raised here in the Quad Cities, actually, in the west end of Moline, now called the Floreciente neighborhood. Went to Alleman, graduated from there, went down to the University of Illinois, got my degree in bioengineering and chemistry minor. While there, worked at La Casa Cultural Latina, helped promoting a peer retention program down there. And then went to medical school at the University of Illinois at Chicago, where I also served as the co-president of the Latino Medical Student Association. So I've been involved with Latino issues from the very beginning, really, and really tried to kind of advocate that when I came back here to the Quad Cities about 10 years ago. So I've been practicing here ever since.
Well, thank you so much. We're really excited to have you here and helping us with this panel. We also have Dr. Colette Hostetler with the Muscatine branch of Unity Point Health Trinity. Welcome, Dr. Hostetler.
Thank
you. Could you tell us a little bit about you? You know, you're also very important with the Latino community and a little bit outside of the Quad Cities, which is even more important.
Mm-hmm. And I would like to give my introduction in Spanish, if that's okay.
Of course.
Estoy muy alegre para estar aquí con ustedes esta noche en esta manera. Yo viví en Puerto Rico cuando fui pequeña, entonces, porque hablo español, me gustaba tener una práctica de medical que incluye personas de quien hablan español y trabajo aquí en Muscatín, en la clínica que está cerca del hospital. Tengo muchas pacientes quien hablan español también. Y yo pienso que es muy importante para servir estas personas también. Yo recibí la vacuna también cuando en diciembre el primero y en enero el segundo, porque yo tengo muchas pacientes quien tienen diabetes, la presión alta, cáncer, enfermedades inmunológicos y por eso, esa es la razón que yo lo recibí, porque no quiero saber que yo transmití la infección a mis pacientes. También tengo una mamá quien tiene 99 años y para abrazarla, para besarla, eso es lo que es importante para mí.
Mm-hmm. Muchas gracias, thank you. Would you like to sum up a quick little bit of that in English as well for English viewers that are watching?
Sure.
Or at least why you got the vaccine at least?
I I have a lot of patients who have high risk illnesses, and I received the vaccine so that I knew that I wouldn't be, or I had lower risk for transferring infections to them, as well as to my family. I have a 99-year-old mom who I haven't been able to hug and kiss for over a year. And so, you know, and also I'm not going to lie, I got it for myself as well. I don't want to be sick. So lots of reasons to get that vaccine. Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much. And we also have Janet Hill, the Chief Operating Officer for the Rock Island County Health Department. Good to see you, Janet. We usually see you on TV at the, you know, Quad City Coalition calls. And thank you so much for being here with us.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me. I've been a lifelong communicator, and 5 years ago, I moved into public health after earning my Master's of Public Health degree from the University of Illinois Chicago. And it is really important to me that all members of the Quad City community understand how important COVID vaccination is, and then also still following the public health guidance that we've been talking about for a year. We're not going to be able to stop wearing masks for a long time, but you can take that action step right now and get your vaccination. It's really important for not only you, your family, but the entire community.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Janet. And we'll start with you first with the questions. We know there are concerns, especially with the Latino community, about personal information being shared when receiving the vaccine. Could you explain whether information will be shared and why on the intake form it might ask you those kind of questions like your address or your race or ethnicity?
Sure. So any healthcare provider, including public health, takes your health information very seriously and your privacy very seriously. We will not be sharing any of that information with anyone, including ICE or any immigration official. There is no worry about that. We do keep that information so we can keep track of what vaccine that you received in case you have forgotten. And to make sure that we ask for the ethnic or racial backgrounds, to make sure that we are distributing the vaccine fairly and equitably. We know that people of color are not getting vaccinated as quickly as white people, and this is one of the reasons why we're doing this forum. We want to set everyone's mind at ease.
Mm-hmm. And is there a price associated with the vaccine at the clinics or if you go to your private doctor?
There is no charge for the vaccine. Now, some private healthcare providers could charge an administrative fee to your insurance, but there is no out-of-pocket cost to you. This is a federal asset, and the federal government has paid for it. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. And vaccine rollout continues to grow throughout the U.S., with many of us able to get the vaccine within the next month or two if we haven't already. Dr. Hostetler, why should we get the vaccine? Why not, you know, let others get it first if we believe, you know, I'm 23, I'm not at the highest risk? Why should people like me or others still get it?
Well, you know, because we are at lower risk for, or younger people, I should say, are at lower risk for showing signs of having the illness, that doesn't mean that they might not be transmitting it without having those symptoms. And so that would be asymptomatic carriers. And transmitting it to people who they have contact with, such as anybody that they run into and spend a little bit of time with, especially if they're unmasked, can spread that virus very quickly.
Mm-hmm. And would you also mind going over what is in the vaccine for those of us that aren't in this medical field? We might not really understand what's in it. Dr. Hostetler.
So the vaccine contains a variety of different things. The three vaccines that we have in the United States, two of them are mRNA vaccines, and I believe Dr. Terronez is going to go over that in a little bit. Mm-hmm. They also have just some carrier molecules such as polyethylene glycol is something that we sometimes use for constipation, and people might know it by that name. There is not, as some people are concerned about, things like aborted fetal cells, for instance. They're all just carrier substances, as well as the virus in the Johnson & Johnson type of vaccine that has that vector in it that carries that into the cells so that we can produce immunity to those cells.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Dr. Terronez, would you like to jump in and also explain to us what all is in this for those that aren't entirely familiar?
Absolutely. So yeah, so this has been probably the biggest concern for my patients mm-hmm. is about how this is new. It seems like it's new, but the research behind this is not new. When we talk a lot about what Dr. Hostetler mentioned about vectors and messenger RNA, a lot of us don't know what that means. Like, to the general population, they don't know what that is, and that's okay. So that's kind of why I wanted to explain it. And when I explain it to my patients, they usually like that. And once they understand it, how this thing works, it tends to immediately kind of appease them and calm them and make them feel a little better about it. So to give you an idea kind of what this means, to kind of give you a little lesson in cell biology here, okay? So basically, everybody's body is made up of a large amount of cells, right? And a cell kind of has inside of it a little nucleus. And inside that nucleus is where you have DNA. So you're going to hear that about DNA. And DNA makes something called messenger RNA. Just like it says in the title of it, messenger means it goes from inside the nucleus to outside into the cytoplasm in the cell. That messenger RNA literally looks like a ribbon, and it acts like a blueprint. So that blueprint is read by something called a ribosome. Don't worry about what that means, but basically it literally 3D prints it for us, and it makes a protein molecule. Protein folds on itself, and that protein is used in our body for everything. Anything from making muscle tissue to generating nerve issues. I mean, the scaffolding of our cells. I mean, just constantly being used and regenerated, right? So, but that messenger RNA doesn't stay in there very long and naturally falls apart. So a long time ago, actually in the 90s, we wanted to utilize this messenger RNA for good things, right? Making, muscular dystrophy, making muscles, using it for cancer treatments, etc. What we found out is that when we tried to inject that messenger RNA into our body or where we want it to be, it didn't work. It falls apart, right? It's too unstable. It's a ribbon, so it just falls right apart. And basically what they found also was that your immune system recognizes it as foreign, so it kills it. That's not what we want, right? So basically they came up with this thing called vectors. So vectors, when we use that word vector, it's literally just a bubble. Okay, that's the easiest way to describe it. It's a bubble. And what we do is, instead of actually injecting the messenger RNA by itself, which we know doesn't work, we put it inside this little bubble so our immune system doesn't attack it right away. So these vectors are not new. We've known about them for a good 15 years. When I was in undergraduate, 15 years ago, I knew about the adenovirus vector that's been going on at Johnson & Johnson at the University of Illinois. It was being taught about. So we were actually figuring it out back then. The lipid vector that you're going to hear about when we talk about the Pfizer and Moderna, uses a lipid molecule. Somebody really smart figured out how to make a cell membrane. And what happened is they basically utilize that cell membrane, put the messenger RNA inside of it, and when you inject it, it links up with your cell and merges. I think we have a graphic of it that I wanted to show you that the CDC brought up. This is kind of a good visualization from it. It's actually on the CDC website as well, both in English and in Spanish. So feel free, because this is a lot of information to take in for a person who doesn't know science very well. Those little ribbons there, that's the messenger RNA. So inside that bubble, that lipid bubble that we're talking about, when you inject it, it drops off that messenger RNA. That messenger RNA actually makes the spike protein, that protein that's on the coronavirus that we talk about. Coronavirus has these little spikes that stick off of it that it has to have. Every picture you see those little spikes sticking out. And what happens is that basically they need that to get into the cell. Because they need it, we know it's going to be there. So this messenger RNA literally will have your body make that spike protein. So why would we want our body to make that? Well, that spike protein that's sticking off on the little tips there, that spike protein is foreign. And our immune system sees it as foreign. It's not supposed to be there. So it kills it. And when it kills it, it sends a message to our cloud You know, the basically anybody with an iPhone knows what the cloud is. It seems to store everything. Well, it stores this as well. So when it stores it, your immune system remembers it and it makes something called antibodies. These antibodies literally look like a Y. Okay. And on the tips of that Y, now they can detect those little spike proteins that are sticking onto the coronavirus. And on the bottom end, the little butt end of that Y, it's like a beacon. And it tells your immune system, hey, this isn't supposed to be here. Kill it. So your immune system now has a targeted attack on this virus because it knows where those spike proteins are. Now, that, I kind of explained like how that targeted approach is kind of like, if you're thinking about like war people know about, like if you laser a target, like a lasering a target, you know, like in a building full of other buildings. So that way it's focused right only on that one building. That strong attack is what we're looking for. And basically when you get the booster shot, the Pfizer and Moderna, it's the body recognizes that, hey, that spike protein is back. We got to remember it now even more than what it was the first time. So that's really the how that works. That's why our immunity goes from 54% effective, the first Pfizer and Moderna, all the way up to like 95%. So much, much better there. The Johnson & Johnson uses something called an adenovirus, the activated adenovirus, which is basically a cold virus that's been gutted. And all we have is the little shell, but it's a little hexagon shell. And they just put the put DNA in there instead of messenger RNA. And it basically drops that off into the nucleus. And you same concept applies. It makes spike proteins that our body recognizes.
And I've heard people... Yes, it was. But it's really interesting. I like the visuals and the T and the Y's and all of that. So we had a lot of people concerned that it changes your DNA. So that is not the case in this, correct?
Very true. Very good question. It does not mess with your DNA. The reason why is because when your DNA makes messenger RNA, it can't go backwards. It can't form DNA out of messenger RNA. It's not possible. The only way that's possible is an HIV with reverse transcriptase. Don't worry about what that means. It's extremely hard to do, okay? It's not possible. The other thing with the DNA that is dropped off by the Johnson & Johnson, the Janssen vaccine, that double-stranded DNA cannot link to your DNA. Even though it's inside the nucleus, it's kind of like explaining a person's house and having a shed next to the house. It can't combine. It's just separate. So, and it still breaks down. That's the other thing too. These things degrade. They don't stay in your cell for longer than a day. So they are gone as soon as they're done. So they're not going to stick around.
And we're getting a comment asking about how long we are immune. Do we know that data yet? And Dr. Hostetler, if you'd like to jump in, or Dr. Terronez.
These are new vaccines. And so, you know, those studies are ongoing. We will see how long they are. I think, you know, one thing that we're pretty sure about is that the immunity that we get from the actually having the infection is shorter than what we have seen with the vaccine. And that's one of the really good reasons that people, even though they have had the COVID-19 infection, should go ahead and get vaccinated. You know, some people are recommending that maybe you wait 90 days, and some of that is so that other people can have availability of the vaccine, whereas people who have had the COVID-19 infection might still be protected for that period of time. But you don't have to wait for that 90 days. You take that vaccine when it's available to you.
Exactly. Yeah. So, I mean, COVID's only been around a year. Honestly, it's only been around for a year. We don't know how long immunity is going to be when the vaccine's only been out for 6 months, really, or studied even, or out in distribution for 6 months. We don't know. We're still learning that as we go. It's looking really good so far when it comes to the antibody response and the effect on a population. Like in Israel, they did a study where it's showing that it's actually driving it down dramatically. Even in our hospital at 50 point, they show a literally an inverse relationship where the numbers are going down as the vaccines went up dramatically. That's just in our work population in our hospital, so that's limited, but we're seeing it already. So time will tell.
And could you go over the effectiveness of the vaccines? And because with Johnson & Johnson only being one dose, it does have a different effective percentage than, for example, Moderna and Pfizer.
Absolutely. So basically for that one, when we talk about prevention and then the morbidity and morbidity part and mortality aspect of it, it's kind of a little bit two separate things. So prevention, when we talk about 95% prevention, that's really good. And like Pfizer and Moderna, it's right around there. As soon as you get your second vaccine and 2 weeks after, that's really, really good. That prevention part of it is saying that if I had COVID and you were vaccinated, I cough on you, but you, coronavirus comes to you, you're not likely to feel any symptoms at all or even know that you had it for that short period of time while your immune system fought it all off, right? So that's what that prevention part of that is. The second phase of this is how, if you do get coronavirus, what is your likelihood of having it so severe that you end up getting hospitalized, like we've all had our family members have, where you get hospitalized, have to stay in there, get on oxygen, get in the ICU, get intubated, all that stuff, or actually dying. And dramatically, the Johnson & Johnson, even though it doesn't have as good of numbers for the prevention part of it, dramatically decreases the hospitalizations and death rates. So that is phenomenal. So in that aspect of, even though you can get it, you're not likely to get the severe forms.
Thank you. And Dr. Hostetler, could you go over some of the possible side effects that we might see from this? Because on the first, I mean, I've only gotten my first dose, and I know my arm was a little bit sore, but nothing I couldn't handle for more than a day. But we know with a second dose, it could be a little bit more severe.
Yes, yes. Good point. You know, some of the side effects, of course, are just those localized kinds of effects that we get with every vaccine, you know, just some soreness, some redness, maybe, you know, some swelling of the arm. And some people get a little bit more severe, but that still isn't the kind of reaction that we really worry about being an anaphylactic reaction. So other kind of system-wide effects can be fever, just fatigue. Some people might get some nausea. Headache is a pretty common one as well. And for those, you know, we suggest not premedicating before you get your shot, because you want to give your body the chance to react to that vaccine, to do what it's supposed to do. And we really feel that some of those side effects really mean that your body is doing what it should do. And I was kind of bummed when I got my second shot. I just had like 20 minutes of chills after about 10 hours. So don't be afraid of those side effects, but you can, after you get the vaccine, if you really feel like you need to take some acetaminophen or ibuprofen, talk with your provider about that, and it, you know, that might be okay if you're really feeling badly. Cool, wet, clean cloth on your vaccination site can be helpful to maybe not need to take one of those pain relievers. Make sure that you're hydrated. Exercise your arm. You know, it sounds kind of counterproductive to move a sore arm, but we really see that that is helpful for it not to get as stiff after you get your shot.
Right.
And I would add that before you get your vaccination, we found at our clinics that it's really important, as the doctor said, to stay hydrated and to eat a little something. We've had some people feel faint while they're sitting there in that 15-minute waiting period. We've had no serious reactions, but we have had a couple of people faint just from, you know, improper nutrition that day.
Sure. Always a good reason to eat a little bit in the day. And Janet, also, you know, once we get our vaccine, let's say I'm fully vaccinated and then I want to go visit my family who is also fully vaccinated. And the CDC had new guidelines recently that we don't have to wear masks, correct? And we're with people that are both fully vaccinated. Could you go over some of those guidelines that we've seen?
Sure. So this is really good news to a lot of the grandparents who have been waiting to hug their grandkids. So if you have two fully vaccinated people, they can meet indoors without having masks. If you have one vaccinated person and one unvaccinated person from just one other household, you also can meet indoors without having a mask. When you're talking about being in the general public, you still must wear your mask, and that will be with us for many, many more months. We don't yet know what herd immunity is, but we know that it's many months away. So just because you get your vaccine does not mean you can ditch your mask anytime soon.
And could you go over some of the Quad Cities guidelines? We know that Illinois and Iowa, you know, just crossing the river, you can see a difference in the amount of mask wearing. What are the guidelines in Illinois and Iowa?
Sure. In Illinois, we are still under a mask mandate. So that means that anytime you are in public, you are required to wear a mask. And most stores and restaurants and businesses are enforcing that. We do have indoor dining at this point. In Iowa, there is no mask mandate. However, the Scott County Health Department and all of our healthcare partners are strongly, strongly suggesting that you wear your mask. We know that they work, and we have strong metrics to prove that. We had very, very little flu this year, and flu and COVID are similar respiratory illnesses. They are not the same, but they are transmitted the same way. And by people wearing their mask and watching their distance and washing their hands, we had virtually no flu in the Quad Cities and all across the country.
Wow, that's very impressive. And with, you know, once you get your first vaccine, how far apart should you wait until you need the second dose for those that receive the Pfizer and Moderna vaccine? Does it need to be, you know, 21 days on the dot?
It does not. For Pfizer and Moderna, you can go a couple of days early. And to, the optimal window is for Pfizer is 21 to 42 days. And for Moderna, it is 28 to 42 days. But the CDC and the FDA say, if it's not available to you within that 42-day window, just get it as soon as you can. Now, vaccine availability is becoming much stronger, so we do not anticipate having to go past that 42 days. We have much more vaccine moving into our community, and we believe that we're going to be able to get people vaccinated here, you know, in the summertime.
Thank you. And we actually got a question about whether there might be a site or a clinic in East Moline. Is that something that you're able to comment on, Janet?
Yeah, we are working with a church in East Moline, and we will have some details to announce very soon. But we're working with Pastor Harris and his church in East Moline, and we're hoping to be able to get several hundred people vaccinated in the coming days. Now, our mass vaccination site at the Camden Center in Milan is open 6 days a week, and the ways to register for that are on our Facebook page, the Rock Island County Health Department's Facebook page, and our website, which is richd.org. So it's important to look at those links, look at those sites often, because sometimes we have a little bit of problem with the vendor getting links as quickly as we want. And we know that's a little frustrating to people. They want to be able to plan 3 weeks in advance. We just don't have those links available yet.
Thank you. And as a reminder, if anybody has any questions they would like, and as you're watching this, and please send them in or put the comment in, and we'll be able to get those answered for you during the session. So please make sure you comment if you have a specific question you would like to have one of these experts answer. And there was also a question about COVID-19 having a high survival rate, and asking why is the vaccine necessary. Dr. Terronez, would you like to jump in on that?
Sure, absolutely. Yeah, so I have this discussion with my patients all the time that I concede 100% that the mortality rate for coronavirus is really low. Okay, somewhere between 0.5 and 2%. I admit that. Yes, you are absolutely 100% correct. But you're forgetting about the morbidity factor, right? A lot of things in medicine that we care about is about morbidity and mortality, right? Morbidity, what is that? That's the long-term effects or how bad you feel when you are sick with something, right? When a person has a stroke, they don't always die from that, but they have significant morbidity. They lose function in an arm. They can't swallow. That's very, very damaging to your life. And that's something that we as physicians care about, sometimes even more than mortality at times, okay? So when we talk about the morbidity aspect of coronavirus, we all have seen it. We have family members who have been in there. I've had people who've been in there that have been in there for 7 days, 2 weeks at a time, intubated for a long period of time. And now even coming out, even as a physician now, I'm seeing my patients having prolonged symptoms, talking about how they can't taste, they can't drink coffee anymore because it tastes like dirt, right? I had somebody tell me that today. You know, like just really prolonged symptoms, you know, like where they're feeling fatigued for extended periods of time. One of my wife's grandfather was a professional cyclist. He's barely able to walk right now. He's still working on strengthening himself 3 months out. So that's the severe morbidity. And that happens more like 20% of the time. 80% of the time, usually you're going to be fine, right? It's especially more prevalent in the younger generations. You're right. It's going to be better at that point. But the thing is, you still have that higher risk. 20% is a lot. Okay, that's a lot of a morbidity factor. The other thing, it strains our system. If you, our hospital systems are only designed to really hold a person in a hospital for maybe 3 days-ish. When you're hospitalized for coronavirus, you're there usually around 7. So it adds up because they're supposed to be, people are supposed to be leaving, but they're not. So when they're not leaving, the beds fill up. And now if somebody over here has a heart attack or a stroke and needs to get into an ICU bed and they can't get in. We had this happen. This isn't something that could theoretically happen. It happened in November. My patients were being shipped to Rockford, to Chicago, to any place that had an ICU bed. So to say this is possible is not true. It happened. And it can happen again if we don't stay ahead of it.
So a fourth wave, or you know, whatever wave we're on right now, could still happen if not enough people get their vaccination or rely on others to say, I won't get it because we'll reach herd immunity without me. That might not be the case.
That's true.
Dr. Hostetler, would you like to touch on that or explain, you know, how this could happen again or why, you know, herd immunity might not quite be reached as soon as we would like?
I think Dr. Terronez just, you know, hit on that very well. I worry about the younger people, you know, who feel like they're invincible. And, you know, sometimes I feel like that myself. I'm way past that point. Why should I get it when I'm being as careful? But you know, we all want to get back to doing things that we have done in the past, and that's going to mean that we're going to have a lot of contact with each other as well. And you know, there's really no real contraindication to getting this vaccine other than having had an anaphylactic reaction to a previous vaccine, and that usually means that you had to go to the hospital. That you had swelling, a hard time breathing, and certainly, you know, you should talk to your provider if you've had that kind of a reaction to a vaccine before to see if there was something specific that you were allergic to and maybe you could get the vaccine, or whether it was a mixture of things. And if you really don't know, you might not be a candidate for that vaccine. But again, medical conditions, there really aren't a lot of medical conditions. There may be some medications that people should, again, check out. Those people who take medications for immunocompromising conditions like rheumatoid arthritis or lupus, some of those medications should be put off for a little while so your body has the chance to do what it should before you take those other medications that affect your immune system. But there are really very few contraindications to getting the vaccine. Pregnancy, you know, a lot of people wonder about pregnancy and whether that's something, a reason that they shouldn't get the vaccine. And that really, you know, is up to each pregnant individual. Pregnant women or persons were not included in the study. But however, some of the people who received the shot did then get pregnant. And so those pregnancies are being followed very closely. And I believe that I heard not too long ago that some of those people had delivered and that they actually saw antibodies in the placenta, but not causing problems with the infants. I'm which is a good thing. I mean, show that there was production and maybe some protection for those infants. So, you know, we'll have much more information as we have more people getting that vaccine who are pregnant.
And for those that are breastfeeding as well, as it as well, just advice, talk to your healthcare provider. Will that, do we know if that might affect an infant through breast milk?
Yeah, there are some studies that are being set up and initiated to look at breastfeeding populations. But it is, that's a population that is recommended also to get the vaccine. Doesn't look like there are contraindications to that.
Thank you. And somebody is asking, are those medications listed on the inserts? Does anybody have an answer to that? If the medications listed that you should not take are listed there?
If I remember correctly, I don't remember seeing any specific medications listed.
Okay.
Are you talking about the medications that are the immunocompromised people?
I would believe so. I see it's just that question listed on the Facebook and comments.
Yeah.
So we have a few medications out that I know Unity Point has put out a little bit of documentation for us as the research has gone through about which specific immunocompromising medications limit the benefit of the vaccine. Not saying that you can't get it. It's just saying that you're not going to get as good of that immune response to it. So you might not get that full vaccine benefit from it. We got a list of those medications that's very patient specific, like things like methotrexate can be a little bit more of a problem. I can't remember some of the TNF alphas, but I can't remember exactly which ones off the top of my head. They're big, long names. And I'm not a rheumatologist, so I'm not quite sure on them either. But yeah, so I'm not quite sure about all of those ones, but each one of them, the rheumatologists are aware. Where you're usually the people who are administering those kind of medications, and they are going to be the ones, if you have a rheumatologic disease, that you want to talk to. Same thing even when the pregnancy situation, every obstetrician has their own thought process and logic as to how they want to vaccinate their pregnant women if possible. Some want to wait till after the first trimester, etc. There's a lot of different things that come into effect that affect them.
Thank you. Another question is if one of you can talk about ADEM after vaccines. I'm unfamiliar with that acronym, so if you could also explain what ADEM is, that'd be great.
So that stands for acute disseminated encephalomyelitis. It's kind of like a neurologic overproduction, if you want to call that. It's kind of like your brain starts overheating. I don't know if that's kind of the way I would kind of put it in a layman's terms. Basically, an almost like an autoimmune response. Your own immune system going a little too ballistic in the brain area, and it causes very severe neurologic deficits. That's happened in. That's probably one of the biggest fears by a lot of people with vaccines in general, because when you're stimulating your immune response, they worry that that kind of thing is going to cause neurologic autoimmunity as well, and. I know they've had, you know, a lot of people have worried about, especially with MMR, the live attenuated vaccine causing that scenario. The case reports on those were not traumatic. They're there. Like, they're there. Like, the VAERS criteria, one of the things that we look at in VAERS is a reporting, by the way. VAERS is a reporting, by the way, for immunizations when you're having a really bad complication. And they use that and they kind of tally up. They have had deaths. These kind of very neurologic diminishing issues. I haven't seen anything about ADEM in this one. No, I haven't seen anything about it. You know, I've heard a lot about Bell's palsy, but that one didn't actually funnel out when they actually compared it to the general population. It was the exact same. So that one didn't pan out. That was a huge one. I was worried about that one. What else? But yeah, I haven't heard about ADEM specifically in this at all. The death, I remember hearing about possibly a physician passing away right around the time that the vaccine happened. But they haven't found the correlation. So just because something happens around the time that you report it doesn't always mean that it's because of the vaccine. In the general population, you can get hit by a car on the way out. You can have a stroke just randomly in the general population. So what they do is they look at the millions now of people who are being vaccinated. Is this happening? it more than the general population. So that's why I said about Bell's palsy, that's actually about the same. And actually one of them is actually a little less. So these are the kind of things that we're seeing. So yeah, ADEM, I haven't heard anything about that in this one yet. So, but I'll keep an eye out. I'm keeping an eye out. We're all looking, sure.
Of course. Yeah, there's still new information coming out every day, it seems. So it's always important to keep an eye. And that's why it's good that we're asking our local health experts about it. Another question we received is, why aren't we pushing better nutrition and healthier living instead of vaccines? I understand it should be both that we're pushing, but Dr. Hostetler, Janet, would you like to jump in and say, why they're both important or why we should just be pushing healthier living instead?
I'll start. Yes, we are pushing healthy living. That's one of the hardest things, in my practice, is to get my patients to try to live a healthier lifestyle. But, the viruses really don't care about healthy living. I mean, the way that they're spread is they take advantage of our systems. And you may do a little better if you're healthier. But I have some pretty healthy patients who were hit hard by the infection. On the other hand, I have some sick patients who did not do, who did better than what I thought they might. And I don't think that there's any rhyme or reason. Yes, you should try to stay as healthy as you can. But I don't think that that's the complete answer to this epidemic.
Yeah, I tell everybody, number one, you should be doing nutrition and healthy living anyway. Number one, first and foremost, all my patients, good. Yeah, I know we all need that. But the thing that I notice is that really, this is all odds, right? The whole thing about this whole thing is odds. What is the likelihood of you having, a bad hospitalization or death from having coronavirus? Yes, it's higher when you're obese, which is what we preach all the time, right? To get your exercise in and eat nutrition, healthy living, stuff like that. To decrease that obesity factor and kind of keep that the likelihood of those bad things from happening, you should be doing that anyway, right? So no matter what, that's how you're going to boost your immune system in general. So obviously we want you to do that. And yes, we're preaching you to do that on a regular, consistent basis, but that weight ain't going to go away in a month, in 3 months. In order to get to that level where you need to be out of that obesity stress, that takes years. Okay. Yeah, usually, and I have that discussion with my patients all the time. Don't expect to lose all your weight in a 1-3 month time frame and expect it to stay off. In order for it to be actually medically beneficial, you need to have it off and consistently keep it off. That's how you know you're going to actually be healthy to fight off the serious infections. But like she said, like Dr. Hostetler said, the virus is going to fight whoever it wants, and it's going to find somebody who has the weakened immune system at just the right time to go ballistic. So,
Thank you. And Janet, I've seen on the health department's Facebook page that the vaccines are now eligible for some that are 16 and older. And, how has that changed, the vaccination clinics, and also, how do you think that'll just affect the Quad Cities overall as well, having, more people start to get vaccinated at different ages?
So if Illinois meets its metric of vaccinating enough of the senior citizen population, we will be able to vaccinate every adult on April 12th. Now, it's important to remember that only people who are 16 and 17 can receive the Pfizer, and that's per the emergency youth authorization from the FDA. Moderna is only approved for 18 and older. So it's really important if you have a 16 or 17 year old to get the Pfizer. Right now we can do 16 or 17 year olds who are frontline essential workers, and next week we're gonna be able to do restaurant employees or people who have, we currently also can do people with some chronic medical conditions. So I think that heading toward April 12th, there's going to be a little bit of bottleneck at the beginning, because then everyone is going to be eligible in Illinois. But in Rock Island County, we've already been seeing most of our population be eligible. We have a lot of frontline workers. We have a lot of people with underlying health conditions, and we have a lot of elderly people in our county. So we have been treating it as if everyone is available at this point. And we know that that's not 100% true as far as every single individual patient, but you know, at the population level, many of our residents already were eligible.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Dr. Terronez, I've heard, you know, a few people say that they've experienced worse side effects with Moderna than they have with Pfizer. Is there any information to back that up by any chance, or is it psychological or just individual basis?
Not really. When you look at the numbers as a whole, it's pretty much the same. I'd say, you know, like we had talked about a little earlier, I tell my patients, you're going to get a sore arm. 70% of the time, you're going to get a sore arm. So just expect you're going to get a sore arm. You're going to feel flu-like. Expect to feel flu-like, but some people don't get any symptoms. Like for me, for example, I was knocked out hard after my second Pfizer. But there hasn't been actually a true difference with the kinds of side effects that you get, the fatigue, headache, muscle aches, you know, cramping, tiredness. All that stuff is still pretty similar on both sides. I haven't found one being more likely to do it than the other. Even the Johnson & Johnson, people are getting this side effect profile too with the first couple of weeks from the few people that I've seen that have actually gotten it through John Deere, et cetera. So I haven't seen much of a difference when it comes to one less likely to give you the side effects than the others.
Mm-hmm. And exactly. And those that say they just want the Johnson & Johnson because it's a one dose, is there any, should they wait because it's just a one dose? Should they get whatever they can as soon as they can sort of situation?
Our recommendations are still to get the first one you got available to you. Mm-hmm. Honestly, don't wait because you don't know. Because even my 65 and ups, when we had it kind of more focused in the 1A, 1B kind of scenario, I was like, you don't know how many people are going to be rushing in the 18 to 25 years. What about when the 16-year-olds jump in? Now you're going to have to wait at the end of the line. Now you're going to have to wait another week when you could have had it 3 weeks ago. It's like, and that now it's circulating in the population. That, you know, when they talk about these mutations of the current coronavirus, the reason why it's mutating is because it's more around. The more it's in the bodies of more people and the more it overproduces and expands, the more likely you are to have genetic variation. When you have that genetic variation, you're going to get more stronger viruses. Just like us, they get stronger when they kind of figure out how to get work around our systems and how to work around our ways of blocking it. So it's the same concept. So the longer that it's floating around, the more likely you're going to have bad new strains that our current vaccine doesn't quite touch. It won't get to it as effectively. So get what's available to you right away. None of us want to feel that cruddy with the side effects twice. Have to wait 3 weeks to go do it again. But honestly, as long as we're getting it, the sooner we are to getting back to some kind of normalcy, honestly.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And most sites have been really good about scheduling the second vaccine when you get the first vaccine. And so we're really trying hard, you know, to make it easier for people to get those vaccines.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And Dr. Hostetler, with the AstraZeneca vaccine rolling out in the EU, we've seen that there have been some reports of blood clots. Is that something that we should be worried about here with the vaccines we have now, or if AstraZeneca does roll out in the States?
Well, you know, I think it's like some of those other things that we heard, some of those adverse events, everything is reported. And so those clotting events were not greater than what we see in the general population. And so it's not clear. It doesn't look like those were actually related to the vaccine, but may have just been not random, but not caused by the vaccine, sure, but would have happened anyway. But of course, you know, all of the vaccine producers, yeah, I take those very seriously, and so are looking very hard at whether the vaccine is causing, you know, some problems or not.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Janet, we got another question for you asking about Johnson & Johnson vaccine availability at the clinics. Do you know if there is a date that those might be coming into Rock Island County or when we could expect them?
We have a few hundred coming into the county every week. We have been prioritizing them for our partners, partnership with the Alternatives for the Older Adult. There are some extremely medically fragile people who need immunity as quickly as possible and have transportation and mobility issues. So we want them to have the one dose and be done as quickly as possible. So for the foreseeable future, until we get more vaccine from Johnson & Johnson, it most likely will be Pfizer or Moderna at our clinics.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And when somebody goes to the clinics, is it possible to get a translator there on hand, or is there a way for them to get access if they do not speak English?
Yes, our staff, there are many people on our staff who speak Spanish. And at the clinic, there are National Guard soldiers who speak Spanish, and there's one person who speaks French and one person who speaks Korean. And if it becomes a serious translation issue, the health department has access to translators in many languages. And that is the same thing for the community healthcare and Trinity and Genesis and the Scott County Health Department. There are translation services available. Language should not be a barrier here. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. And something else that we've just added at our station is a news section in Spanish. So we have a lot of our resources there, and I do translations for the things that you provide, Janet. So thank you. So that's also a resource for those that are interested. You could go to kwqc.com, and now there's a new section called Noticias, where we have all of this vaccine information in Spanish available as well. Dr. Terronez, I see that you would also like to add something at the end.
Yeah, so I just kind of wanted to say something a little bit more personally, because I wanted to at least, you know, incorporate it into my thought process in general. Like a lot of you out there, you know, I'm sick of coronavirus too. I'm sick of, okay, like I've had enough of my patients coming. And what I'm really sick of is I'm seeing so many people depressed and anxious, financially strained. And that's really, really bothering me. The biggest concern that I also have is that, you know, when I decided to come on this panel, because personally, me too, my fam, I'm sick of hearing about my other Theo and Thea over here who have died, are currently hospitalized over in Peoria. I'm tired of hearing about it, honestly. I'm overwhelmed with it, if you will, you know, and I'm sick of it. So I decided to come on this panel today to really kind of preach to you about how we want to get back to that kind of normalcy. Normalcy, we got to do something about it, because it's been a year and we haven't figured out how to treat this. We really have not figured out how to treat coronavirus effectively to keep you out of the hospital. The only thing that's worked so far has been the vaccine. And I know I'm not going to get everybody to change their mind. That's fine. But I do want to at least make sure that you're not scared of it. I don't want you to be afraid of this vaccine or the fear of it being new to be something that inhibits you from doing something that could be right. We have disproportionately, Latinos being disproportionately more sick, more likely to be hospitalized, and more likely to die from coronavirus is unacceptable. And the fact that we are now less likely to get vaccinated to prevent that goes against logic. And that is something that we have to work hard in our communities, talking to our family members. I can only do so much. You have to be the one to talk them into it. We all got that stubborn feel. It was like, I ain't getting that, right? No, I'm not gonna cuss. So that's, you know, they all come out and say that they don't wanna do it. We need you. I need your voice. I can only do so much. And I really hope I touch base with more people today. And I really hope that you can spread the word, honestly. And if you have questions, if you see me on the street, I don't know who you are, I don't care, ask me at this point, okay? Because I really want to get, back to normalcy too. I want to hug my family. I want to be there for my birthday, those birthday parties, everybody there, the pachangas and stuff, man. I want that, okay? So, but I need everybody to get on board too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, my personal opinion.
Thank you very much. Unless if anybody has anything else? Does anybody else have any other closing remarks that they would like to share? Okay, well, if that is it and I don't see any more questions, I think that wraps it up for us tonight. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us. The panelists, you were all amazing. And thank you for everybody who joined us in the comments and live with us. And if you have any more questions, you can still add them in if you're watching this after it has already aired. It will also be on WVIK's Facebook page, and their YouTube, as well as KWQC's Facebook and on our website. I would like to thank all of our sponsors as well, Unity Point Health Trinity, Unity Point Health Trinity in Muscatine, the League of United Latin American Citizens, LULAC, the Quad Cities Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, Community Healthcare, Muscatine County Public Health Department, Scott County Health Department, Rock Island County Health Department with Janet, Martin Luther King Center, WVIK, and KWQC. And again, if you would like to have more information in Spanish, we have that on our website and news app. All you have to do is go to kwqc.com/noticias, where you can get all of these resources in Spanish. So please get your vaccine as soon as you can. Vacúnate, por favor. Es urgente para poder resolver esos problemas y regresarnos a la normalidad. Muchísimas gracias. Thank you, everyone, for watching. Have a great rest of your night and stay safe.